You can sugarcoat it, you can paint their tank, but they're literally locked up.
I'm KP, a marine biologist, and you're watching another Currently. Today we're taking a look at a video and even furthermore a concept suggesting that we can replace animals in zoos and aquariums with robots. So let's dive in and see what we think.
This might look like a real dolphin, but it's a robot.
Nobody believed it was a robot. Everybody believed it was real.
It's an impressive feat of engineering, but it's a much bigger deal than that. This robot could save the marine park industry and free the 3,000 dolphins, whales, and porpoises that are basically
locked up.
In no way, shape, or form will the introduction of these robotic animals free whales, dolphins, or porpoises currently under human care. These animals have been deemed non-releasable by government agencies. Agencies like the USDA or NOAA in the US, or the DFO in Canada. And I think a common misconception is that zoos and aquariums are making the decisions on whether or not to release animals into the wild. Zoos and aquariums can make recommendations, but in the end, the government makes all of these decisions. Okay, now that we've cleared that up.
You can sugarcoat it, you can paint their tank, but they're literally locked up.
Okay, stop. Locked up is an absolute false analogy. It is a catchphrase designed to be impactful and make you feel a certain way, but it is not grounded in fact. Animals in facilities have dedicated staff that give them around-the-clock care. And that's not to say that animals under human care don't have specific challenges that we as people need to strive to meet. They're just different challenges than those out in the ocean. But all of the sea otters that you see in any of my videos here on YouTube, over on TikTok, Instagram posts, all of those animals were orphaned as pups and rescued, rehabilitated, and deemed non-releasable by the government. Most of them were abandoned by their mothers before they were even old enough to know how to swim. And if zoos and aquariums didn't exist and didn't have live animals, then all of these sea otters would have been euthanized. And in these cases, I believe these animals lead full and happy lives, and euthanasia is not in their best interest.
That's the complicated problem with zoos and marine parks. On one hand, we lock up wild animals for our own entertainment. On the other, they provide the only venue for everyone to see and interact with the natural world, while also contributing millions to conservation and rehabilitation efforts.
Okay, so I really do appreciate their willingness to admit and talk about the positives of zoos and aquariums. Because a lot of times I find that videos paint this as a very black and white issue, and I don't believe that it is. If you follow me on TikTok or Instagram, or if you've watched any of my videos, even attended my live streams over on Twitch, you will know that while I do support zoos and aquariums by and large, I do understand that there are problems and limitations to what zoos and aquariums are doing right now. And there are aspects of zoos and aquariums that absolutely need improvement.
White tigers, I definitely do recommend, like, if you're gonna go to a facility and you're like, oh, they have white tigers, look a little bit closer as to why they have white tigers, because white tigers are just like inbred tigers and it's pretty horrible.
So for me, the truth is in between the black and white, somewhere in the gray in between.
But what if this robot could keep the upside and eliminate the downside?
It's easy to kind of demonize the marine park industry as a whole, but we don't think that's the answer. We just want to transition them to the future in a much more sustainable way.
This is Just Might Work, a show about surprising solutions to our biggest problems.
Is it our biggest problem?
Back here, this is actually the original mold from Free Willy. The kernel of,
not the example you think that it is.
Really did start with Free Willy.
20 years ago, Walt and Roger Holzberg built the first free swimming animatronic. No big deal. The mechanical challenge was hard enough, but the key to making it all work was to create something that felt real.
You don't necessarily think about it, but there's no blueprint for creating a dolphin. So we study tons and tons and tons of footage, looking actually at motion profiles, which ultimately relate to accelerations and torques. Inside, they're all machines. They're all joints and servos and microprocessors and stuff. But what makes a dolphin or an orca or a shark or a beluga distinctive is actually the art and knowledge that we bring to it.
See, I think what makes those animals amazing is the fact that they are living, breathing, thinking animals. And I think that if I went to some kind of exhibition like this, I'd come away with a really strong appreciation for the animatronics, the engineers, the technology. But I just don't know that I'd come away with an appreciation for the animals that it represents and with a strong connection to try to drive conservation. I don't think that seeing a robotic sea otter would be the same as watching Katmai or Joey play. Maybe I'm wrong though. I don't know. Let me know in the comments.
A lot of interesting things happened when we piloted these attractions. All of the fish in the entire aquarium believed the dolphin was real. The sharks avoided it. The turtles were terrified of it. The small fish...
I also don't know that this means that they thought it was real. They thought it was scary, certainly.
Schooled underneath it, but the dolphins can echolocate, so they certainly could tell there were servos and plastic in this thing in the tank.
Those early successes led them to the most important question. If the robot could fool the animals in the tank, could it fool us?
Okay, so this is what I don't understand. Is the idea that we're not gonna tell the people that the animals are actually robots? Like, are we advertising them as live animals? Because I don't see any way that they would lie to the community about what was going on here. And I just am not sure that people would go to see this over the opportunity to see live animals.
There are only a handful of marine parks left in the US, and attendance has steadily declined. But that perception shift hasn't been the case everywhere. In China, business is booming.
Okay, here they're showing footage of what are clearly not North American zoos and aquariums. I cannot speak for what is happening in other countries. I don't know their practices. I can tell you that in North America, the animals receive exceptional care. And there are studies that back this up. Again, those links in the descriptions below. But I'm just not really willing to comment on practices that are happening in other countries since I simply don't know enough about that.
But it has created the perfect opportunity for Edge Innovations to show there's a new way forward.
About a year and a half ago, out of the blue, I get an email from a producer working on a large oceanarium initiative in mainland China. And they've just done the math on what it's going to take to acquire pretty large number of large marine animals. And somebody said, boy, I wonder if you could do this animatronically.
We currently are finalizing contract for an installation in a major Chinese coastal city.
I'll be very interested in seeing how this goes. Will this work?
Replace a real dolphin with a robot dolphin. We have seen dolphins and orcas doing acrobatics in arenas for 50 years. We want to create a whole new set of experiences that this technology allows.
There are some limitations to the current iteration.
Okay, see, so to me, these up-close, in-water interactions, they don't work if you know that it's a robot controlled by a middle-aged man behind a curtain. I could see this maybe working if we're looking at a big open kelp exhibit with sea turtles and species of fish and suddenly a few dolphins swim by. But for an interactive in-person encounter with someone this age, they'll know that this interaction is staged. The fun in these types of encounters and interactions, in my experience, is the unpredictability of them. Animals don't always do what you want. They have their own personalities, their own desires. At times, they're not interested in the food that you have. They have better things to do.
Joe! Joe, come here.
And then you're left explaining to the guests why the dolphin is playing with something over there rather than coming over and hanging out with you.
Okay. There's no sound coming out of your mouth, sir. It sounds like a squeaky, no.
Or you might have an animal that forms a particular connection to a person in the encounter group. And I just don't see how you can replicate that with animatronics.
It's attached to a wire for now and is controlled mostly by an operator. It's also expensive, but the numbers pay off over time. While this dolphin costs between $3 and $5 million to make, it's far more economical in the long run.
As it turns out, the cost of entry of animatronic animals is significantly more than buying their live counterparts. But over a 10-year lifespan, it saves many, many tens of millions of dollars.
Okay, I can believe that because animals are expensive to house, but I'd like to see the numbers here. Sure, ideally all you have to do is plug it in at night, it recharges, and is ready to go in the morning. But anyone who has owned any piece of technology knows that this isn't true. The average lifespan of an iPhone is 3 years, but most people see a decline in performance after 2. And how often do you service your car? I mean, 10 years is eons when it comes to technology like this.
What may be the most powerful feature of the robots is also impossible to measure.
I want to know.
And that's the opportunity to actually interact with a wild animal.
Experiential,
but it's not a wild animal.
That you create, like Del the dolphin, is the deepest and most effective type of education. With our animatronic creatures, they've bonded in a way that that kid is never going to forget. And our hope is that that love and that feeling is going to make her want to protect those animals when she grows up.
We actually want to expand.
Again, there are scientific studies that show that people that interact with animals at zoos and aquariums come away with a better knowledge of those animals and a desire to help conserve a species. One survey found that 86% of participants' understanding of marine mammal conservation changed after watching a live stream of a baby sea otter for a year. But I just don't see that happening with robotic dolphins. And maybe these kids will believe that the dolphins are real, but at some point they'll realize the truth, and will they still care about dolphins? I have lots of doubts. I feel like the age range at which this would work is very limited. Anyone over the age of 12 would definitely know that they are not interacting with a living creature.
We live on a fragile planet, and we want to use that experience of recreating the past oceans to let people be entertained and enjoy, but to point out the fact that nothing's given. These things are fragile, they're all interrelated, and we got to take care of the oceans.
Okay, I really like a lot of what they have to say, and I'm grateful that they appreciate the role that zoos and aquariums play in conservation and public outreach. But one thing that they don't mention is that they would lose both the research and the ability to rehabilitate animals if this model moved forward. And I don't think that enough zoos and aquariums are talking about this. SeaWorld should absolutely be singing from the mountaintops about the work that they do in research and rehabilitation. They rescue and release thousands of animals every year, and they are one of the biggest contributors to the understanding of our oceans. A vast majority of that research is not possible in the ocean, and it is definitely not possible with animatronics. There are things you cannot mimic. You cannot mimic perfectly dolphin skin. You cannot mimic perfectly the airflow through a dolphin's lungs. You cannot mimic perfectly echolocation. And that's because animals, unlike robots, are not perfect.
It's perfect. It's perfect in every way.
I've talked about some of the research that I've personally participated in under human care. You can find a little bit more about that up here.
So this is part of a research project that I actually helped out with, working with our dolphins who were trained to allow us to put tags on them so that they could actually sort of hone those tags.
So that's what you lose if you replace animals with animatronics. You lose the ability to do this vital research. And you lose the ability to do rescue programs because you have nowhere to put animals that cannot be released. And I believe you lose at least some of the educational value and the drive for conservation. Maybe I'm wrong, and it'll be interesting to see if something like this ever actually does come to fruition. Let me know what you think down in the comments below. And I'll catch you next time. Cheers.